know Christ is with us. Thank you for sharing in this time of worship. It's a blessing to be with you here at First Church. I remind you to find some registration pads to your right and left. It is a help for us to know you're sharing your worship, so we invite you to sign those pads, pass those to your neighbor as we gather and prepare for worship. As we do so, I hope you're mindful of ministry opportunities before us, especially for this coming week. Remembering the ministries and jams, Avoid the Noise this afternoon, Puppets and Children tomorrow, also our finance committee will be tomorrow, in preparation for our annual charge conference. The Tuesday's Touch Sculptors are still before us each Tuesday. I invite you to enjoy being part of those, and then also our building committee is at Parish on Thursday. Mentioning the charge conference, that will be 2 weeks from today, October 18th. We will share this charge conference with other local churches. Jeanine Howard, our superintendent, will preside and is presenting three questions for us to consider as we consider the ministry to which God calls us. Those questions deal with resources, deal with context of ministry. I share this as part of my pastor's letter, and I believe they're also in the newsletter. So I invite you to ponder those questions as we prepare for our charge conference on October the 18th. We are also aware that for the past 3 Sundays, we've been sharing a stewardship campaign, focusing on the mission that is entrusted to us for the sake of the gospel. That mission to love and worship and serve the glory of God. So 2 weeks ago, they spoke to us very powerfully about the ministries of welcome. Last week, we heard our worship ministries from Captain Hendrick. Today, we will hear about our mission ministries, the means by which your giving helps us to serve God here at First Church. So as we receive the morning offering, we will be reminded of your gifts translated into ministry for the sake of the gospel. So again, if you've brought your pledge cards with you, you want to offer them at this time, that's fine. I know some of you have already done that, and if you haven't dropped those and you're still considering your commitment to the ministries of this church in 2016, we invite you to bring those cards next Sunday or may start to send them to the church office. As we begin worship, we also begin a new worship series. The bulletin cover reminds us of a portable faith, practical faith. How do we carry that faith that we proclaim in this place of worship beyond these walls? So as we share the gospel in particular this morning, we'll be invited to consider and to remember the faith we proclaim here as we live beyond this place. I pray we'll share that series with you. On God's sustained, our call for worship is to us. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord.
Give thanks to the name of the Lord.
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper and bless you.
Peace be within your walls and security within your towers.
For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be within you.
For the sake of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek your good.
Thank you.
Make us ready to hear, to respond in faith and obedience. In Jesus' name. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, whoever you are, when you judge another, for passing judgment upon him, you condemn yourself. Because you, the judge, are doing the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls upon those who do such things. Do you suppose, O man, that when you judge those who do such things, and yet you yourself, you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume upon the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience? Do you not know that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? By your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. For he will render to every man according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are factious, do not obey the truth, but obey wickedness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand and sing as we prepare for the day of our Lord.
Give to everyone who begs you,
And of him who takes away your goods, do not ask them again. And as you wish that men would do to you, do so to them. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. Love your enemies. Do good. And lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the selfish. Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful. Judge not, and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. The measure you give will be the measure you get back. This is the word of our Lord. Portable faith. Now we can mention any number of this place. Now, as soon as I say this, I feel the resistance to having said this. Because I can hear the question offered in response, don't we already do that? My answer to the question, well, I'm sure. I'm sure that to a great degree, we do already do this. We do already take our faith from here to elsewhere. I have spoken with you, and I've seen you in ministry here at the church and in many other places, making those sacrifices so as to share in the ministry, saying no to many other things in order to say yes to ministry. So I know in many ways you carry the faith we profess at this time and place to other times and places. Still, there is a word coming to mind as I approach this service in the next several weeks as we speak to portable faith. That word is this: relevant. Relevant. As in, just how relevant do we believe this Christian faith to be? You understand the question? We gather in this place that really looks like no other place, right? I mean, this place is somewhat limited in its functionality. We're not going to set up basketball holes here, ping pong tables. We're not going to bring in office equipment to this place. It's fairly limited as to what can happen here. This is the place where we sing hymns. This is the place where we read scripture. We speak confessions of faith. We pass the peace. Once a month, we take bread. We take a cup. We announce Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Not only is this unique behavior, it happens in a unique setting. I mean, in here we have a pulpit. We have a communion table. We have offering plates. We have stained glass. We have altar candles. We don't even sit in pews here. Where do we sit? I mean, excuse me, we don't sit in chairs. We sit in pews. Some of us dress differently here. I wear a robe. Choir's wearing robes. Finley's wearing a robe. All God's children got a robe. So all this makes for some unique, if not odd, behavior. Behavior that, again, may have us questioning its relevance, its portability. So is the question not a fair one, that question being, how do we carry faith confessed within a place that looks like this, a faith to which we witness by practices offered only within a place that looks like this, into those places that don't look like this? How do we carry this faith to places where, if we practice the behavior there that we practice here, others will find us quite strange? So you understand the questions about relevance. And you know that no doubt many who make the decision not to do what you and I are doing this morning would say they just don't see what we are doing to be relevant. What difference does it make, this singing and talking and praying, these ancient and archaic practices with a strange decor and ritual? Frankly, we have more practical activities to which to attend. What you all do on, in there on Sunday mornings belonging to church and audience, it's nice and respectable, but really, what difference does it make? So how portable is this? Now, I doubt seriously, we are the first ones to confront these questions. To be honest, I can't help but believe these questions are as old as the faith to which they are directed. They have to be questions offered in some fashion to these works of faith that are before us this morning. I mean, do we really believe that those who first heard or read these words of Jesus responded to them without question? Do we believe they heard these words about love of enemies and responded, okay, Jesus, you got it. No problem. We'll do. Anything else you want to ask of us? No, I'm guessing that many of them as well wondered about the portability, the practicality of living the Now you know the circumstances in which I speak, where we may speak those questions. Circumstances in which we wonder, can we really put into practice words such as these? When we go to the office and have to work with the one who has spoken falsely about us? When we go to the family reunion, having to face the family member who has mistreated others in the family for personal gain? When we go to school and have to sit in class with the one who has broken our trust? Though everyone here knows these words of Jesus to be words central to the Christian faith, have studied them in Sunday school, learned them in Bible school, seen these on bumper sticker or book cover, heard the words as subject of a sermon before, we have also known the difficulty of living according to these words of Jesus. Even now, each of us can bring to mind those circumstances in which we confronted with great difficulty the challenge of all our enemies to do good to those who hate us, bless those who curse us, to pray for those who abuse us, to turn the other cheek. We've known the challenge to live by these words, and we'll know that challenge again. I've known in years past the pain of being the subject of the whispered parking lot conversations, the phone calls, secret conversations initiated with the higher-ups. And I say this not for dramatic effect, but rather as confirmation that each one of us at different times has to turn and face these words of Jesus. As we do so, we notice Jesus does not qualify these words. He does not state those conditions in which they are to be lived. The words are not offered as optional to discipleship. Central to faith, before us again this morning, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Turn the other cheek. Here. That's tough. Especially tough for those of us who enjoy spending time in the abstract and the theoretical. You know, all that head stuff that embraces mystery and the well, what if. All the stuff that keeps the nuts and bolts practice of this faith at safe distance. You see, for some of us, talking about the mysteries and wonders of faith is more to be desired than actually jumping into faith, taking it for a test drive, and seeing how it ends. Then those of us who would rather stand at safe distance, analyzing, wondering, well, what if, are struck to realize that we follow one who did not talk about the wonders of the Eucharist. He gave himself in bread. We follow one who did not talk about the virtues of denying ourselves. He gave his life for us. We don't follow one who mused about the wonders of praying for those who harm us. He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing as they kill them. We don't follow one who from a great distance speaks of some new way of life. Instead, the Word of God became flesh You see, what tells us? What tells us Jesus is saying these words don't apply beyond Sunday morning? What is there within the scripture telling us these words are not portable, that they're not to be carried beyond this place? You're right. Because we hear what Jesus is saying, don't we? You're to be different, Jesus says. You're not like everyone else. You love your enemies. You pray for those who persecute you. You turn the other cheek. In other words, why bother following me if your life is going to look like the life of everyone else? You're different. You don't belong to the world. You belong to the kingdom of God. Life is different within the kingdom of God. You live as residents of the kingdom of God. In the kingdom of God, enemies are loved. Those who mistreat us are prayed for. Bruised and beaten cheeks are turned. So if I've lived such a life as this, says Jesus, why would those of you who follow me live any differently? Just know this, says Jesus. When you're mistreated, you're not victims. Those who follow me are not those who delight in being victims. Instead, you are those who take the initiative. You witness the life as it is lived within the kingdom of God. You witness to the victorious life secured for us all. Life secured in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The difference, says Jesus, you're different. You belong to none other than the kingdom of God. It's a kingdom extending even beyond this holy place, a kingdom that is carried into this neighborhood. Thank you. give to us the assurance that, lo, I am with you always, reminding us again you're not alone. So, Lord, do not give up on us, we pray. Speak to us again these words of salvation, these words that call us to live a life, showing that you live, we belong to you above all. Lord, in your mercy, hear us as we pray for the people of this congregation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Pray for their well-being, back to their best interests, to leave thoughts of vengeance. hear this good news, that God has forgiven us by sending his Son to die for us. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven.
Thank you, God. Amen. Let us stand as we welcome one another and ask the peace of Christ. Gather with the singing of Be Present at our table, Lord, to see that.
Two ways to shake it down. Looking at it from 100,000 feet distance. We have outposts and outreach types of mission work. In terms of outreach, we go out or send things or money out or people out. And we do support Grace Network Henry Ford missions with financial contributions that come through the church, as well as food that we package up for now that goes internationally. And we also send the most recent trip, Pastor went with youth group and Megan on a trip to Georgia. Youth have done other international type trips as well recently. But in terms of outpost missions, think of the church as a lighthouse where we bring people come to us. And some of that is benevolence, which I personally categorize as DNA, do not ask. It's one of those things where if you really, really, really need to know, they'll get the information to you, but that's personal and really desperately needed help and we gave it to them. But the other ones are closed closet, lunch rush Tuesday and Thursday, where we provide a meal as well as send people home with bags of food, small emergency type of food rations, and then monthly food bank where we fed 1,200 boxes of food packed year-to-date, roughly. Almost 4,000 people fed through that year-to-date, and we're about to pack another 100 backpacks. None of this happens without financial contributions, and none of it happens without volunteers. And I know all of us would love to have more volunteer help. Things will ramp up dramatically as we move into the upcoming ministry center. And just keep in mind the tag and the bulletin
Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offered for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Well,
stations from which you may receive the bread of God for the Lord's Supper. If we have some ushers who want to move to the piano, then they give us a little more room here. But if not, that's okay. Our choir will converse.
Give ourselves